And so the battle begins.
Oh my goodness. Also, I'm going to get a drink. I'll be right back.
The battle for Rook's Rest, which when it starts, you're immediately like, ah, this is going to be a big thing. Lots of money is clearly involved in this one. There's people everywhere.
Oh boy.
There's all kinds of effects. And yeah, they're moving forward, and so arrives Maelyse, in which Gawain is like, you moron, Cole. They're doing the thing that we knew they would do. And then Cole's like, teehee, just as I planned. And Gawain's like, what in the world do you mean? Why would you say that? And they send up a signal, which is prepped for a spooky little sneaky Vega who's sleeping in the forest. Which, before we go forward, because I think I talked to you about it, Theo, a common criticism is, how did Vhagar sneak in there? What does everyone think? How are you feeling on that before we go further?
There are ways to mitigate the damage, I guess, but for me, like, Vhagar is too massive of a creature to get anywhere at any point without people for miles around knowing about it.
Yeah, like, even if they traveled at night, they'd probably, you'd still, like, when
you would
land,
hear Vhagar.
Oh, she lands, oh, yeah, maybe. You know, like,
the imagine? Ground would shake where she lands, yeah. You would hear her wing beats, like.
Yeah,
well, I mean, the signal goes pretty far, because they shoot up the arrow, a guy sees the arrow, he blows a horn, and then I think you see two more horns, at least, with them implying that they're going to be more.
What if somebody along the way saw, you know, as Vhagar traveled, and then that got around as well.
I guess medieval forces have scouting, like, faculties. They have this capability, and you can't really stop people from scouting.
I guess I can believe, though, that if it's at night and he has cloud cover and he's above the clouds, like, how is anyone reasonably going to see him other than another dragon rider that happens to also be out?
Like I said, you don't necessarily have to see him. You can hear him or her, Well,
but I mean, like, if you're on Dragonstone, you got to consider there's like the sound of the ocean
as well. Not everyone involved in this is on Dragonstone.
So are you talking about the people at Rook's Rest,
just
I guess?
People
then?
At Rook's Rest, whatever forces they have, they would have scouts around the area.
Well, I don't know, though, because you got to think, if they're like 100 kilometers away, then I don't think it would be reasonable to think that you would hear a dragon from 100 kilometers out. And as I said, they have a bunch of horns that they seem to blow, indicating that Vhagar is actually probably quite far from Rook's Rook's Rest. I guess that's the way I saw it, at least. Anyone?
That is how I see it.
I just got back. What are we arguing about?
I think that Aemond would have left late in the night. He would have flown all the way up, as we saw in season one, so nobody is going to hear or see Vhagar until you get all the way over to wherever they've aimed for Rook's Rest. I think Cole could easily have scouted ahead himself to find a good spot that would reasonably have, like, nobody around to tell Aemond where to land, and then Aemond would have gotten there, and it would have been a handful of hours, not even that long, before the plan would be enacted, so the scouts from Rook's Rest have to find and report Vhagar in that time, which I don't think is reasonable.
I suppose that's viable, yeah.
It's viable, I really struggle to imagine nobody finding Vhagar. I really struggle to imagine it.
In the woods at night? I just don't think there'd be anybody out there.
No scouts?
Well, so even if in the morning, for however many hours they have, if the scouts move in such a way that they would be able to spot Vhagar, which is, you know, Vhagar's relatively camouflaged, which we're shown that, even if they are, who's to say there aren't counter scouts waiting in case any scouts were to spot Vhagar, ready to kill them?
Well, that's not really how that works in medieval combats, Odyssey. You can't really... It is not strictly feasible to stop people from scouting in that manner. You can't build plans around denying the opponent intelligence by killing their scouts, because the likelihood of your ability to catch them is extremely low at the best of times.
Yeah, but we're not talking about a totality operation. This is just a handful of hours.
Sure, but I don't know why the same principle wouldn't apply.
So, again, Cole, make sure ahead of time to find a position that, as Mark pointed out, is relatively far away, because two horns have to be sounded to get to the alerting Vhagar to move. They don't show us exactly how far away Vhagar is. And then that position, I think Cole is smart enough to know where a good position... They can't scout everything in that amount of time.
Sure.
And so all it needs to be is a relatively safe place and to drop several scouts around the area that are pro Vhagar to keep an eye out in case anyone was to stumble across Vhagar that they could kill. And even then, if a person stumbled across one, was killed, what are Rook's Rest going to report exactly? And then even if they did, what they're going to ask for is, help, we've got a dragon here, which would send in, presumably, a dragon in defense, but we don't even get that. It wouldn't be enough time. I don't think this has any issue. And I think it's actually an unreasonable request. Like, I don't think there's that many scouts for Rook's Rest. It's a tiny castle, and where would they place the scouts if not more in favor of where the army is coming from, which I think Vhagar was placed behind. As not necessarily behind Cole's army, but behind Rook's Rest, like in a place that would never be expected for anyone to be coming from.
I mean, I think it checks out. And plus, if the plan wasn't to work at any time and they were ready to execute the plan, they could have pulled out if they wanted to.
Well, the fact is, if they even spotted Vhagar, Aemon can bring her up and just burn the fuck out of Rook's Rest and then leave. That could always be the plan too.
That's true. I suppose that's probably the most important part then, is if they got found out, does that change whether or not he would even still consider it viable to just follow through on this plan anyway? The answer is probably no. Like, no meaning he would still do it.
Yeah.
Yep, I get you.
Hey, I'm still willing to be argued into it. It's just with the cover of the hyper high shit they showed us in season one, I don't think there's any visual or sound anyone's picking up until the come down from there to Rook's Rest. But Aemon's a pretty good rider. Vhagar's a pretty good veteran dragon. I don't see there being much chance.
Maybe they could go quietly, or
not necessarily that they would be silent or anything, but they would come in as quiet as possible, as far away as possible, and then that means we're relying on some distant flapping sounds that I think could be written off by anybody, if not heard, not at all.
Yeah. Yep. But
then it would also just be the landing as well.
Again, it's just going to be so far away, which I assume they did that on purpose with us, showing us that how much sound had to be, like, what signal was required to get Vhagar into
multiple
the battle.
Signals. Yeah.
But with that, we can begin the big scene, I suppose. Because I think it's fair to make sure mechanically that this functions as well, however well we assess it does, because this is possibly my favorite scene of the season that isn't very, very character related, right? Like, it's a battle scene, but I guess what else would it be at this point? Because there's not
been... You described the whole sequence then in that case, which almost feels a bit unfair to say it's the best one when it's like 15-20 minutes.
Yeah, it's not short. A lot of things happen. So, with everything that's been set up, Aegon is on his way in, which is a huge shock to basically every character except the audience if you've been paying attention to just how much he wants to prove himself, right? Like, nobody's expecting this to happen. It's going to fuck everything up. But what's interesting, I think, is on his way in, he spots Maelys burning the shit out of everybody, and he, like, commands Sunfire to attack. You gotta give him some courage points.
Oh, yeah, the guy's fucking ballsy. Absolutely. He's a brave guy.
And, you know,
you might be able to say
it's strictly he's just trying to get glory, but you could also argue maybe it is partly due to him being like, I'm the king, I gotta do this, I gotta help him, sort of thing. Maybe. It's hard to say definitively exactly what's going on in his head.
Well, yeah, I mean, if the reason he's going out is so that he can do stuff and be respected and be seen as kingly, that makes a lot of sense that he would use that as a reasoning for it. If he's not being respected as king, and he manages to pull this off, then that's going to get him some insane reputation points in his mind, certainly.
Yeah, and moving over to Cole, that's getting started up already. He immediately moves into a speech of talking about how his king is here, your king is here to support you. This is essentially approved by the gods at this point. We're going to win. We're going to dominate. Help him get out there. He's helping you. We're helping everybody. We're going to win. This war is ours. And
win bigly.
It was very much cool to see, instead of writing him so that he panics and runs away or anything, he rallies the men as best as anyone can and gets them in and uses this situation, which is a complete shock to Cole, to his advantage, at least as best he can. And he's obviously very mad at Aemond right now, because this shouldn't be happening. And so, yeah, Rainy spots Sunfire, which I imagine to her is probably pretty easy as a fight. Especially if she's experienced.
Well, especially when you pair her experience with his inexperience.
Yeah. With, like, easy pickings for melees.
Yeah, which gives us our first dragon fight, which they do such a good job of in this episode in general. But we'll go through it nice and piece by piece. They're heading toward each other, and Aegon's strategy is breathe fire on her. And that's that's nice, I guess, as a move. It's you know, it's what dragons do. But
and he fires way too early.
Yeah, it barely gets to the target, and it blinds him and Sunfire. Both of them show like they can't quite see or move properly after he does it. She dives down straight away, Melis.
You did her a favor.
Yes, because she dives down and then swoops right back up and immediately claws the belly out of Sunfire. It's not even close to fair as a fight.
That's gruesome too.
Brutal, and yeah, just the screaming, and then you see Sunfire's blood splatter across a bunch of the enemies, burning them, or rather not the enemies, their allies, because dragon blood burns hot is a thing in this universe. But before Sunfire can fully recover, Melis comes in and starts biting the right wing off, which is it's just, again, it's kind of like you gotta do it this way from Melis and Rainy's perspective.
Dead, yeah.
Yeah, just gotta kill it as fast as possible. And it's seen as like a fuck yeah, we're totally winning, you know, Team Black. And then the Lord spots Vhagar coming in from the distance, and
it's so awesome every time seeing Vhagar.
Yeah,
from the ground,
it's such a GG thing. It's just like, because Vhagar just represents game over. That's all that is. But yes, they're sort of tangled, Sunfire and Melis. And Aegon is obviously very happy to see his brother is here to save him. Kind of sad, to be honest with you.
Vhagar, help me!
Great performance, too.
You know what's
definitely
about to
a
happen.
Lung of the King moment, yeah.
Yeah, and he's like, thank the gods that he gets a bit melted, because Vhagar cooks him. But
yeah.
They do take effort to show that he's falling, right? And it's complicated. Like, a lot of people had fights over whether or not this should have been the death of Aegon from what we see. The main thing for me, because I think that Sunfire would have slowed down the fall significantly just by having wings, even wings that aren't fully flapping, but it's the landing and this little explosion you see, the fire. It's like,
yeah.
I wonder how much damage that would have done to Aegon, actually.
Sunfire just cough or fart when he landed or something.
Maybe.
Good old filmmaking vocabulary, right? Like, if you see it from a distance, you got it as a question mark. When you see it close up, then you know for real, mostly, unless you're dealing with some...
Well, and
that just seems to be the way it works. You see it at a distance, you're like, well, I mean, we didn't see exactly what happened.
There's that, and then there's also just, man, if Aegon survives, the storytelling potential, you know?
Yes, that's the main thing.
Well, like, the armor actually also adds some believability to him surviving.
Well, that's like the in-universe explanation, the narrative one, of like, from a writer's perspective, is, man... Like, he knows what Aemon did. That's some great drama, like, that you could just tap into if you keep him around.
Well, he's down and possibly out. Cole's on the way to help him out, and Aemon is probably relatively happy with his decision, but the curiosity is, Melis has the chance to escape with Rhaenys, and Rhaenys decides not to. She turns around. Is possibly the, a big ol' discussion as to exactly why, because this show doesn't have her shout out why, so we have to discuss it. Unfortunate, but that's where we're at, you know? If maybe in future episodes they can have someone explain definitively what the decision was. Or we can talk about everything that has happened in her life that would make her decide to do this. Does anyone want to start?
So, I think it's interesting that Rhaenys is often characterized more so by others than herself as the queen who never was, that there is this element of the idea that she essentially gives up her life to fight for a queen who's in a position that she should have been in by many people's rights. is an interesting way for her character to end. How she's not like bitter about it. She still sees that she has a place in, you know, in the kingdom and stuff to do. She doesn't have any like anger against Rhaenyra for that, especially, you know, because it wasn't her fault. And that's kind of how she, you know, how she goes to, you know, how she goes.
Sure. To like be clear, what's being discussed is just that she has the clear chance and acknowledges it of escaping, but she chooses not to and flies back into the fight. There's speculation and discussion as to why would she do this when she should probably know that she's not going to win against Vhagar. Like, people have said, why didn't she escape and come back when maybe there was a better chance of doing this, that, and the other thing? I think that, first and foremost, the recognition is from her that I'm not sure she believes she's going to survive this fight. I think that's pretty obvious. Secondly, Vhagar is one of the most important things in this war, and that if she can take Vhagar out, which is it's not impossible.
It can be that she's experienced, and, you know.
That would be a hell of a...
I've spoken to some book readers and stuff who have said, apparently, according to the books, the way this plays out is whoever's narrating seems to give the impression that Meleys and Rhaenys have a chance against Vhagar and Aemond. Like, it could be an even fight, so to say. It was just the presence of Sunfire that shifted things in Vhagar's favor. So I'm not sure how the show feels about that with respect to how it wants us to feel about Rhaenys' chances in this fight, I guess.
Yeah, I suppose, because in the book, there is more of a three dragon fight at the same time, right? This is a plan hatched by Aegon and Aemond in the book, but in the show they've done it differently, which I think Gary said he felt was an upgrade in the show as a change, narratively speaking.
Certainly feels more ripe with characterization opportunities, but
yeah,
I don't know. I haven't read it.
Yeah, I can't necessarily speak to that.
This fight's over a lot faster in the book. Like, it's kind of just one move happens, and then Sunfire's down, Meleys is dead, and Vhagar's fine. Like, and they basically kind of all just spin. Like, that spinning thing when I think it's Vhagar and Meleys do the thing where they're both shooting fire and spinning to the ground. That's kind of all that happens in the book. Like, it's just that they crash together, they spin down, and boom.
In any case, people are dead. Nature of the decision, I do think, is interesting, right? So Shad was one of his first suggestions was that he believed that Rhaenys assumed that she wouldn't be able to escape if Vhagar decided to chase. I'm not 100% sure of that in terms of they haven't really told us if Meleys, because Meleys seems like it would be a pretty fast dragon. Is Vhagar faster because bigger? Doesn't sound necessarily true. Don't know.
Well, they say that Styrax is faster, right?
I think so, yeah. Well, and Meleys, I think they actually describe Meleys as faster, right?
Yeah, something to also add on is maneuverability can be, like, massively advantageous anyway.
Well, I'm not talking about that with just speed of escape, just who's got the top speed. I assume
Meleys might be faster, but even if she wasn't as fast, simply being able to move around a bunch means that you can just, like, run away for a while and probably be successful. You're not just going to be going in a straight line if you're trying to escape necessarily, especially if it can catch up with you.
Well, if she's heading theoretically back to Dragonstone, that would be over sea, so there's not going to be a lot of maneuvering as well until they catch right up.
Well, just in the air, that would be it. Just like trying to get around.
I wouldn't be convinced that Meleys wouldn't have a higher top speed anyway.
In the way they chose to show things to us, I don't think that's what they were trying to get across as to why she didn't choose to flee.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, I don't see that either.
I think the primary reason is pretty much the main thing they've been using with her that we wish they'd have used more of, which is her mistake in episode 9 of season 1, which is she had an opportunity and she chose not to take it because she's got insecurities in relation to, like, she says in the show it wasn't her decision to make or something like that. The writers have said she would never kill a fellow mother, which is just bullshit, and then
I would kill a fellow mother in a fucking heartbeat.
With
the
fucking
war? I would stab that child.
With us, I'm not sure what our assessment was of why she made the decision she made in episode 9. In retrospect, I guess she just didn't feel right, so to speak. You know what I mean? Like, it's like,
yeah, bad vibes, I guess.
Yeah, bad vibes. The war had just begun, technically. The line had just been drawn in the sand, so it just didn't seem to match up. Whatever. that indecision has now, even by her own assessment, cost several lives, several innocent lives all over the place. And so this feels like, I'm not going to make that mistake again. And she's going to move in instead of running away. And she has arguably one of the best fighting dragons available. She has a good shot of being able to win this somewhat. But simultaneously, I get the sense that she's thinking, I'm probably dying no matter what, but if I can take out Vhagar, that actually gives Rhaenyra the best chance in this war that I could possibly give her.
Yeah, because I've already, like, potentially taken out Aegon and Sunfire. If I can now deal with Vhagar as well, that's incredible. Like, mm-hmm. that's almost winning on the spot.
I mean, even if you injure him, that's that's a big deal. Even if Vhagar is injured, and it comes into play to be a very important element in the next episode.
Yeah, and the strapping in, right? So when I was talking about this on the first stream, that was to me a signal that she was like, whatever Maelys's fate is going to be my own sort of thing. Like, I'm not, there's no separation from me and the dragon, but it's simultaneously to me like a, I'm dying for this. We're getting in. There's no, I'm not thinking about anything other than the fight itself. And then, of course, there's the nature of the strategy in the fight. She's going to flip upside down, which I imagine the strap probably helps with. It's just a neat sort of element of the fighting strategy, which, again, she, it's not that Rhaenys has necessarily fought in dragon wars or something. I'm not even sure, with the histories that I'm aware of, that Vhagar's ever fought another dragon, but that they've fought in whatever wars you may have over time, like the Stepstones, for example, or the stuff that Rhaenys has done at the Gullet. They're both older, you know, both Maelys, Vhagar, and Rhaenys. Aemond is actually the least experienced of these four elements, so to speak. But he's still pretty strategic. Like, he's not inexperienced or not untrained somewhat. He's got a brain. Probably,
he seems like the type that would have read a lot about dragon warfare.
And so, then there's the final aspect that I think is important, that also Rhaenys and Maelys, I get the sense from this that they're both pretty tired of this whole thing, that they have spent their lives with the unrealized potential, and then in this war, for as long as it's lasted, which hasn't even been that long, she's just been constantly used to patrol an attack over and over and over and over and over, and this looming sort of, I'm the biggest weapon, and I'm gonna have to be used in some way, shape, or form against their biggest weapon, which is what this is. And so, you know, combine it all, it feels like the decision that I can totally buy, but some people don't think it makes sense. What do you guys think, in conclusion?
I think
it was... Yeah, go ahead.
The most compelling argument I've heard in that capacity is that the show doesn't do justice to Rhaenys' chances in the fight in terms of justifying the decision she makes to go back and tango with Vhagar. Because in the way the show presents it, it feels very one-sided, I think you would be fairly fair to say.
Maybe we should talk about that about the fight, because...
Well...
Sure.
I suppose
it's a question of a choice, one of character and one of tactics. I think in character it makes a lot of sense. Tactically, it may not be like the best move. Would be like, I got to imagine 2v1 would be preferable. Yeah. You know, if you're going to take on Vhagar for real, would be a 2v1.
I guess what I'm trying to get across is that from that perspective, it is tactically justifiable. I think it's justified in character and tactically in a way that isn't made clear by how things actually play out, I guess.
Maybe
we'll, I get what you mean. Like, they showed it play out in a way where she had a better, like, you know,
if it looked like she had a fighting chance
of how it went, and this was like the worst case scenario for her, that if you presented the one where she still lost but she did a bit better, that would kind of convey that it was not like a totally illogical decision that she made.
Yeah.
Also, if we put a pin in that conversation, then until we go through the tactics and the results of the fight, first of all, I was just going to say I love the shot before they first start fighting. So,
yeah.
They do a lot with the dragon cinematography. It's just neat for the stakes of it all. But yes, so as of having strapped in and knowing Vhagar is going to be a much more difficult takedown than Sunfire, it feels to me that both Vhagar and Maelys recognize the best format for destroying an enemy dragon is the talons. That's like something they said they're based on eagles and stuff, right? Like, it's not the dragon fire, even though that would be used, of course, as well. But Melee's flipping upside down and trying to go for the belly straight away, but both of them go for each other that way, and so the talons get caught in each other, and then they start flipping and firing. But to be fair, Melee's is the only one that gets a significant shot on Vhagar in this tangle that we see.
Yeah.
It's a scram into the belly, which would be much more damaging to Sunfire because how much smaller he is, but Vhagar's huge, so that kind of damage isn't going to be as effective, I'd imagine.
It's got a lot of belly.
Yeah, and then they spin and fire and spin and fire until, and I think this is deliberate, they're falling because the wings are not going to be able to keep them up if they keep spinning like that. And Melee's escapes before the ground comes in. Vhagar doesn't. To me, that felt like Melee's did that on purpose. And so my assessment is Melee's wins the first bout.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, sure. I think so. Because they could have left if they wanted to. And I don't know if... Yeah, I think she had control of whether or not there'd be a second fight.
Going in upside down and being more nimble to escape by using gravity to her advantage, it just felt to me like Vhagar's good, but Melee's might actually be better. So this is what I mean by, like, before we get to round two, showing that Melee's didn't have as much of a chance or whatever, I was just like, I don't know, I got an impression that Aemond was surprised by how effective Melee's and Rhaenys were.
I'm sure he was. Though, it's funny, I know that we're meant to be talking about it tactically, but I mean, obviously the symbolic significance of dragons caught in a lock and then dragging themselves and plummeting to the earth.
Oh, it's great, that spinning with the fire everywhere, the dragons destroying each other. It's the best image to represent what this show's all about.
Yeah, that's straight out of the book.
Perfect.
Yeah, well, because that's something I mentioned before, but I don't think on this stream, just that this episode is the realization of the promise of this show from as much as early as season one. People are like, what is this show about? It's like one big family that control a medieval fantasy universe, and they have a succession issue that leads to a civil war where they have dragons on each side, and so there's going to be a war with dragons. This episode is like, yeah, this is what you wanted to see, wasn't it? Yeah.
It delivers on that promise in a big way.
With the efforts that are made in the show, and particularly in this episode, to give the dragons personalities and like that they're not like mindless monsters, they're emotional, beings, and that they don't want to be fighting
like
each other. That's not
it's so simple, but the fact that they care about their riders is something that is really easy to make you like them more as well.
Yeah, exactly.
And I love the when we come back up from the, fade to black, all these men in war running and Vhagar's just stepping on several of them, trying to get back in the air.
Yeah.
It's such
like
a chaos.
You are really
horror.
Messing with powers that are kind of beyond man at this point.
And so,
if I can say one thing about the fight that's very well told visually, to the point where you can tell, like, it's a well-written action scene. And probably very thoroughly storyboarded. And like every shot is just a very clear beat of action that communicates something.
I don't think we could talk about it the way that we are if it wasn't, right? It's just, it's too well done. It can't just be an accident. Yeah. They weren't just do fight. That's it.
Some thought was given to the nature of how dragons fight each other. Obviously taking inspiration from Birds of Prey, right? Like locking talons and attacking with talons. Even though, most people would think of dragons like, well, breathing fire, that's like their main thing, right? But
that's incorporated as an amateur move. It's cool.
Yeah, exactly.
Certainly, if you go too early, it created like a smoke screen that Aegon could not see through that she takes advantage of by maneuvering out
of
his...
Well, it's kind of like in Community when Annie uses a pepper spray but runs into it.
Yes. Just like that.
Throwing a flashbang in front of you with no cover.
I saw a clip of that the other day on the internet. Someone, they had this video of someone yelling someone at some lady at a car, and the lady took out pepper spray and started to run after the car as it was leaving, and she sprayed in the air as she was running forwards.
Why would you
and she did it twice, and then she just stops and grabs her face. It's like, oh god.
A car is very effective armor against pepper spray.
I think a lesser show would have tried to sort of hide the specific beats of the fight in editing,
Yeah, no, I think yeah, right.
It would have just been this, cuts, is, who, this is what the plot.
Here's
yeah,
a bunch
the
of
plot yeah, was like... this person to win, so they win in the end. And what happens in between doesn't matter. This is who needs like, to win for the plot.
Some Michael Bay movies and shit, like, it's just like the editing. It's like, what is even happening? I don't even understand beat for beat, like, what's going on. But here, it's just like every single shot advances the fight in some concrete way. It's like,
no, yeah, it's like. It's a Chad move to have the clarity of a fight for something like this, because that means that they want you to see what they've got to offer instead of trying to hide anything.
Yeah.
It's like, all right, sweet. I'm into it.
I mean, is it fair to say this is the best like live action dragon versus dragon fight we've ever seen in like media?
Does it have I think a it's competitor? Fair.
I don't know. Like
the only one that people asked me about was like there was the one with the zombie dragon versus Drogon in episode 3 of season 8, but nobody could fucking see anything anyway, so.
Was it two dragons that fight in Reign of Fire? It's been a while since I've seen it, but people tend to cite that as one of the better, like,
dragon I don't think any dragons fight each other in that movie, do they? They're all bad guys in that movie.
Well, I guess, then broadening it, is there any other, is there a better dragon scene in anything?
Maybe we're not the selection of people to ask, because I can't think of anything, but it feels like there would be something to compete with this. It must be.
I don't know, nothing's coming to mind for me, at least.
Probably, like, there's gotta be something animated that had dragons fight each other, that's gotta be a thing.
Live action, I did specify.
Well, I know, but, like, animated, I don't know why you would disclude animation.
Well, I guess because then you probably have to be roping in all of, like, the anime fights against dragons and things like that, and it would really broaden the field, whereas having, like, a live action show is obviously also much more expensive.
We should probably broaden the field if none of us can come up with even a single example to compete.
Well, I guess so, but I mean, like, right, if there's no example, there's no example, I guess.
Yeah, because I'm like, Reign of Fire, no dragons fighting in that one, I don't think. Well,
what about Smaug stuff in Hobbit, Desolation of Smaug?
No other dragon.
What? Name, well, name I mean, the other dragon.
But I brought in the criteria from animated to instead going with just dragon battles in general. Like, what's the better one?
Well, at that point, that opens up a huge amount. Like, just generally an action scene that involves a dragon, we would be involved in Reign of Fire, all of the scenes from Game of Thrones. Yeah, well, at that
Hobbit,
point, I don't
Smaug
know.
Action scenes are actually quite bad. Smaug is really, really good when he's talking in that one scene. But other than that, his dragon fights.
When Benedict is doing his.
Yeah.
But I mean, I don't know how it ranks. I love this for its the way the tactics sort of work, the obviously spectacle of it, the character of it. But I don't know how well it stacks against, I don't know, other significant spectacle level. Dragon encounters. Like, I remember Daenerys attacking the Lannister army in Game of Thrones being, like, very effective, but in retrospect, I don't trust anything from
what about that,
post-season
that,
4, you know?
The Iron Fleet one, that was pretty interesting, wasn't it?
I forgot about the Iron Fleet, what are they?
Daenerys has forgotten.
It's just because, isn't it, that the dragon gets hit by, like, 3 arrows?
That's something that gets cited back in videos of mine. That's where I kind of broke a bit. When it got shot, because it's in my video, I think I make it go black and white, and I just start, like, contemplating fucking media suicide. what is the point anymore?
I must desist.
It's so fucking sad to a dragon that's been with the show for that many seasons just gets randomly assassinated. You're like, okay, fine.
Shock value.
Yeah, oh god, it was painful. But anyway... Maelys and Rhaenys get to make the choice again, arguably winning that bout. They look pretty rough, obviously, under the flames. You've got the battle damage, the worn aspect, and you get a look from Maelys that I... Any expression from Maelys I fucking love in this whole sequence. Definitely a sense of, man, we've been through a lot, but the job's not over yet, sort of thing. And especially considering, like I said, from my perspective, I think they won that first encounter, and so they've got to go back and do it again, so to speak. But they're both tired. The battlefield is filled with smoke, and I think they expected that they had done more damage to Vhagar than they actually did. And so, because this part's, I would say, relatively controversial of the fight as well. Rhaenys is looking up, down, left, right. And so is Maelys. They're not spotting Vhagar until they pass the Rook's Rest castle, and then Vhagar goes for the jump scare kill that Vhagar is now famous for.
They already have it.
Vhagar's surprisingly sneaky, I guess.
The thing about me is that it's well, so let's first of all start with this is the controversial part, is that people would rate this as silly that Vhagar could possibly have gotten the jump on Meleys. So how do you guys feel about that?
I think that Rhaenys has proven herself more competent in a dragon rider than to fly that close to a blind corner. Like that, it's pretty much the only place it could have ambushed her from, and she fell like right over it. Flew right over it, as opposed to getting up a lot higher.
I suppose I'm just a little unsure as to the logistics of it all, because I'm not sure like where Rhaenys is going when she starts flying. Like, she appears to be flying in a straight line, right? But so she would be heading like out past the castle, or maybe she's circling the battlefield, but I don't know, that's not the impression I got from the cinematography. But all of that being the case, I again struggle to imagine how she lost track of Vhagar.
I think that's maybe the thing that would be more so of a question mark, is how did she lose track,
get to where Vhagar got, and how did Rhaenys not notice? Because they're clear of the smoke. Where Vhagar comes up from is clear of smoke.
So my impression was, you have Rook's Rest, in front of it is where they landed, the fire and smoke would have filled up the battlefield, Meleys moves away, not really concerned as to wherever anything is, just concerned with don't hit the ground and get space between us and Vhagar, to the point where Meleys would have moved far enough away that she wouldn't even be able to see Vhagar past the smog, and is moving in a straight line away from Rook's Rest, and then decides with Rhaenys to turn around and go back. So as far as they're aware, Vhagar crashed down in front of the castle. That is where they seem to be primarily surveying, but keeping an eye out above and to the sides. And then it's like, where the fuck did Vhagar go? And as soon as they pass the castle, Vhagar comes up. So what did Vhagar do? We assume Vhagar recovered a lot faster than Meleys or Rhaenys expected, got into the air, swooped down past the edge of the cliffside, and then back up and synchronized with Meleys passing by, which was, you know, not necessarily unplanned in terms of, like, there would have been knowledge of exactly where to aim, not necessarily that they would know Rhaenys would come directly into them, but that's where they would have been heading anyway, once passing back up through the castle. What I'm trying to say is I don't think Vhagar was sitting on the castle and then did the jump scare, and once Meleys is in the right place, I assume swoop down, swoop up, and that it synchronized well enough for Vhagar to take advantage. That all seems well enough for me, the variable being that Rhaenys and Meleys were both exhausted. They're not at their top game at this point, and they're trying to return quickly because they think Vhagar is down. That is clearly the impression both of them have. It's only once they spot that the Vhagar is not where they left her that they start getting a bit worried.
I'm just trying to watch it to get a feel for, like, where on earth everyone is. Because I suppose that's what's bothering me about the scene at this point, is my lay of the land is pretty distorted, because to me it appears that Rhaenys is flying in a straight line the whole time, more or less.
Well, yeah, a straight line away and then straight line back, right?
But we never see the turn, if that's the case, as far as I'm aware.
Yeah, we do.
Am I crazy?
Yeah, it's after she looks at Meleys, Meleys looks back, then they turn.
Maybe I'm just crazy, fair enough.
Well, if there's anything else, that's just an opportunity for anybody to raise anything they want.
I still feel so-so on it. I just feel like she would be way more experienced, the both of them, and not having it come out of blind spots would be like one of your biggest concerns. You wouldn't want to be flying close to cover. You want to make sure that you're as far away from things as possible so that it cannot possibly get close to you, without you being able to be in control of what, you know, the angle is or anything like that. I'm so on it.
I just mean, Vhagar is so massive. Vhagar displaces Vhagar displaces smoke by moving, right? And like,
yeah,
I don't know. It is tough for me.
Well, all right then, because the Vhagar bites Bailice's neck, and Radies gets to share a look before Bailice dies and is let go, and the body crashes down on Rook's Rest, opening up a nice chunk of wall for the fall of the castle, which obviously would have fallen anyway, but it's just a bit symbolic of Rhaenys was the only thing stopping Rook's Rest from being taken anyway.
And you know, if Rhaenys didn't burst through the fucking ground in episode 9, I might have said, like, man, what a great character, and what a fitting end, in a sense, you know? But instead it's like, well, I mean, I guess it was a fitting end for what they intended her to be, save for that one scene where she burst through the ground.
What a noble attempt to save this character. People.
Yeah, I mean, to be very serious about this, had that not happened, and I'd be thinking about the story as intended, which is, she always felt, had she not been passed over, that the world would have been directed in a completely alternate way, not leading to this fate, watching her dragon get brutally killed, and then accepting, just falling to her death after everything else that's happened, all the other people have died and will die, and there's nothing to do to stop it at this point. It's out of her control, which is kind of an argument that was made earlier in the episode and episodes before, that it's just, it's done now. This is what will happen. There's loads to work with, but it's so fucking hard to think about all of that and to think about her comments about, like, you know, innocent people don't deserve to die and all the things we could have done to avoid it, when she's still at the top of the leaderboard for killing innocent people. For no reason at all. At least when other people kill innocent people, there's tactical reasons, war reasons, or even reasons that relate to, like, some kind of plan. But she
How
just did it.
How many rat catchers were there in King's Landing?
Maybe that could compete, but the nature of her killing the people in season one, it just makes this difficult to enjoy as they intended.
Yeah, because it just looms over it. It's like, man, you know, like, what an interesting character, except for that one time you were insane.
Except for the mass murder.
Yeah, it's not a small thing that she did on her character. It was a thing that loomed over her entirely, and it fucked with every single thing she said.
Tell people, like, oh, you just have to ignore that. It's like, oh, I'm sorry. I mean, it happened.
Well,
so
to take that argument seriously, part of when we break down a lot of the different these scenes talking about how good they are, we're relying on things that happened before and remembering them, right? We don't just forget things that get in the way and remember the things that work. You have to take it all, because that is what the story being told is, and that's what analyzing it is. I suppose you can, on your personal level, ignore what doesn't fit to make, you know, a bit more meaning come out for you, for yourself. But when we're talking about how well they executed this, that scene was an absolute blight on this show, and the only way to have fixed it was to acknowledge it directly and to have the character face the fact that she's a hypocrite, like, at least somewhat.
Yeah.
But they didn't do that because they never realized it was a problem, that scene.
Well, it's just in the face of, yeah, they realized off, but it's insane. How did nobody notice that was just a huge, why would you do that? Like, they had scenes before where it was clearly portrayed as bad when Daemon, through indifference, like, inflicted lesser carnage on innocent people, you know, like, stepping on that dude in the stepstones. That was obviously meant to be played as, wow, that's bad. Meanwhile, she just, like, burst through the ground.
Even that, you could argue that Daemon would have avoided him if he, like,
if he knew more.
Yeah. You know, like, but it's just like, whatever, I'm getting my job done at the stepstones, I gotta kill the crab feeder.
Bursting out when you know that there are thousands of innocent people above you.
Yeah.
To then do that and then to not end the war. Like, it's...
Yeah. You got all the negatives without any of the at leasts.
Pretty much. It is a total error. But the work that was done in this season, like, with this moment, you know, it's worth commending. It's just dragged down by a decision they made last year.
And I, you know, as much as I despise a lot of what came as a result of that decision lined up with a lot of the lines from her, I have to I do respect the work they did with Rhaenys Targaryen as a character, like, from start to finish, so, I guess.
Yeah.
It's like, there's lots of stuff, like, it's, you know, the one bad scene doesn't, it's what Stannis said, the one bad doesn't wash out the good, but the good doesn't wash out the bad either. It's they're both there.
Yeah.
And yeah, she's out. Aemond is pretty proud of himself. And then we get a surprisingly awesome scene that I wasn't necessarily expecting from this show.
A really important scene for the show and for Cole as well.
Yes. He wakes up in what is essentially a molten wasteland of his men having been just burned the fuck out by the dragon fight. He's struggling to breathe. He's covered in ash. There's just burn victims everywhere. There's screaming, moaning, and just death. It's very well shot, very well acted, very effective. Maybe at one point slightly silly, the whole the suit of armor that falls apart when he touches it, because it's probably wouldn't be that way. But at the same time, symbolically very effective.
I really like the usage of cuts to black in this. Like, the first one happens when he, like, hits the ground. He falls off his horse, and he hits his head on the ground hard, cuts to black.
Yeah.
Think they can't end the episode there, can they? And then it's like, okay, good.
I was so
and then there's another cut to black, and then you think, oh, is this going to be the end? But then we do this, and it's like, oh, cool. See, it's like he's waking up from a haze, and it's like it's so jarring. It's like, you know, this whole field was intact and all my guys were alive, and then you wake up and everybody's dead. It's like horrifying to like wake up to, and
this
adds to the horror of it, I think.
Yeah, this graphic portrayal of, yeah, this thing we said that would be really bad if it happened, this is it, and it's really it we weren't lying, it's really terrible, worse. It's awful. And then yeah. You have just the normal, like, how do people deal with this, you know, terrible violence and, you know, the post-traumatic stuff that kind of comes into play afterwards. And, like, this isn't like a regular war, and those are bad enough. This is something special.
Well, how do they deal with the capacity for destruction that is so beyond comprehension and beyond their control?
It's like, when he gets back up from the ground, it's almost like, am I dreaming right now? Like, is this really happening? This is so horrific. It's almost beyond belief.
He makes his way to his king, where he catches what I assume was Aemond close to finishing Aegon off, and realizing Mad. Just how much. You know, like,
just imagine what was going on in his head when he saw that. Just like, oh my god.
Well, it's worth, because we know this going forward, they had a relationship somewhat. That relationship is over after this. Like, it was kind of cool to see them planning together and talking to each other on a real level instead of, you know, whatever dynamic one would expect the ranks permit. But, you know, that episode one of, like, we move here, do this, this person's doing this and saying this, these people have that. But, like, after this, Cole realizes more than ever that people are playing games who are above him, that have no concern for the damage they're doing other than just the game they play for themselves. And I got to imagine he's having an existential crisis of what the fuck all of this was for, when there was so much sacrifice, and on top of it, he's looking at his king, who, as far as he could tell, is dead.
Mm-hmm.
And why? Because the person that he made the plan with betrayed him. Which all of this was supposed to be for, you know what I mean? Like, it's completely tangled everything up in his head.
That they had a rapport, sort of. It's like, okay, so you're the, for lack of a better term, normal one. You're the one I can actually, like, get things done with. Oh, never mind, you are just as insane as the rest of them, but in different ways.
Well, and this is why I really like this scene for Cole. He's back up, I would say, by the time we get to the end of this episode. He's easily back in a position where I think it's fair to pick him as a favorite. But it's really weird because the discourse for this show online is insane, and he's, like, still one of the most hated characters.
That makes no
sense.
Yeah,
that just isn't... It's not fair. It just isn't fair.
It's weird because he expresses unlikable qualities in unlikable ways, I guess, as opposed to unlikable qualities in likable ways, however the fuck people manage to draw that distinction in their heads.
But he's got so much humanity.
I know, right? But I guess not.
And I've never gotten the impression from him that he wants anyone to suffer in any way. He just wants this to be over.
Yeah,
he hates Rhaenyra.
Maybe Rhaenyra.
You know.
Well, yeah.
She slighted him in a way that he feels is particularly
I was about to
special.
Say, like, if everyone else gets the understanding, you know, so should he. He sees Rhaenyra as the symbol of the destruction of the meaning of his life.
Yeah. Well, and it's also just, you know, like, Aegon, right? Where people are like, oh, well, you know, Aegon, oh, it's like, do you guys... You guys remember what he did?
Yeah.
He's a bad person.
He's pretty bad.
He's not a good guy.
Pretty bad.
Aegon is a very, very bad person.
But it's kind of the nature, when people are actually saying the characters they like or dislike, it's not based on a consistent judgment of their morality, nor is it something that necessarily should be influencing characters that you pick as favorites or characters that you dislike, potentially. It's just that it is kind of like weird that like Kristen Cole is the most hated character.
I've seen people say, like, you know, what I don't like about it is how fucking petty he is, and they'll cite, like, his insults to Rhaenyra. What character in this universe isn't pretty petty?
I mean, it seems at this point, I mean Daemon's really petty, and everybody likes him.
You could argue that it's the height of pettiness from Aemond that he wants everyone dead because they've been making fun of him.
Yeah, exactly.
It's bullied teenager syndrome.
But, you know, it doesn't change the fact that it's what was said. You can cite these things as to why you do or do not like a character, but I just think it's kind of boring in terms of a perspective that you're going to say Kristen Cole is a petty little... do you remember, I was talking to you about it, Fringe. There was a tweet that essentially referred to him as an incel. It was like, he's just an angry little incel. It's like, he's the opposite of an incel.
Is what got him into this position.
But he doesn't even want to have... He didn't want to have sex with Rhaenyra or Alicent, necessarily. They were both dragging him into it. He was like, oh, okay. And now it's cost him immensely. And he just... All he really wants is to be an honorable Kingsguard. But he feels like he can't, because it's too late, right? That seems to be the difficulty he's facing, is that... He feels he's sullied his cloak permanently, and so continues to.
He'll just continue with the course.
Yeah.
Not realizing that he could just start being honorable, you know, in the present.
Having him go through this got me the distinct impression that the show has plans to absolutely give him, you know, a human story, not just a he's an asshole and he'll die story. I expect everyone to die, but I'm just saying that... you don't give a character this POV without caring about how they have something insightful to say about all of this, which he does in later episodes.
Unless they pull a Jaime Lannister again.
Well, do you mean like he goes from everyone assumes he's a one-dimensional asshole to a really awesome character back to being lame again?
Totally abandoning his potential and dropping the ball on his story.
Let's hope not. But that gets us to the end of episode 4, which is considered by many to be the best episode in the series outside of episode 8 of season 1.
Yeah,
I think I'm there.
I'm happy with that. There's a lot to work with. They've paid off a hell of a lot. Like, it does feel like 1, 2, 3, 4 is a package. You watch it as like
a
big old movie.
Yeah.
Well,
episode 4 was important in terms of getting people to accept, like, oh, yeah, okay, yeah. You know, essentially realize, like, yeah, chill out, be patient, let the story play out at a natural pace.
Yeah.
And then you get your big climax, you know?
And, you know, who knows what'll happen next? I guess we do, because we've seen two of the episodes already, but...
Yeah, we do, yeah.